Rajesh, tutor for biology. Today I'll be covering morphology of flowering plants. Briefly, before I begin the lesson, I will run through the website to access revision notes and test in clay6.com. Open the page clay6.com, go to practice, click on practice. Here you have a lot of packages. You can select any package. Since it's for NEET, let me click on NEET Premium. Here you find a lot of tests in each and every subject, physics, chemistry, biology, and NEET full tests. Now, if you click on biology 11th, since that's the chapter we are doing, you see a lot of tests, chapter-wise tests here with bubbles inside them. So you might be wondering, what are these bubbles? So which has colored, if it is green colored, it means to say that the test has been completed. But you can take the test any number of times, even if you have completed. Suppose you have got less marks and then you want to do again the test after 2 or 3 days to see how you have recalled the answer, then this would be of great help. If you have not complete, if you have not opened the test, then it will be showing a blue color. And this red bubble R shows that it is a randomized test. After doing all these, if you get back here, then you to see how well you can recollect if it is a mixed bag. So that's why it's called as a randomized test. If it is in yellow, you might have started with the test, but you have not completed the test. The possibilities are, one thing is you might have not prepared well for the test, or your net connection would have been bad, or whatever is the reason. If you have not completed the test, it is indicating you that you need to complete the test and then carry on. So you will look into these details later. Now, if you click on this bubble of revision notes, it will open into a PDF. And this PDF has been prepared by Clay6 tutors, keeping in mind the key concepts that are very essential for your NEET exams. So it is just like a ready reckoner for you to get immediately to understand what is very important, what is very vital from all the lessons, because you are expected to study so many books for your NEET preparations, which is impossible during the time of revision. So a comprehensive notes has been done by the tutors of Clay6, which I would suggest you can have a look. Now, before that, you all must be wondering, how are the tests going to be? How is NEET going to be? Since it's been taken over by NTA from CBSE, mind you, it is the same. The level of difficulties and the testing pattern all remains the same. But only thing, you must have heard from the people who are given NEET, or from your seniors, or from children, whoever has been very successful, super seniors, they all would say that in biology, you stick on to your textbook. Then is it possible for you to remember line by line all the points from the textbook? It is humanly impossible. So to help you that, the revision notes are handy and these tests come to your aid. Now let me tell you how the 90 marks will be approximately divided in your NEET exam. It is NCERT based. Approximately 68 to 70 questions will be in the examination directly from NCERT books. They can be attempted easily by those who read syllabus religiously as though it's a holy Bible. Now, direct from previous year's question papers, another 8 to 10 questions in the examination can be solved if you have solved NEET question papers of previous years, and these questions are repeated with little or no modifications. That is why if you look at our full term test, there you will be having 15 tests that are teacher made and 20 tests that are from past papers. So these past papers will give you an edge to score better than your friends who have not done all those meticulously. And modified questions, at least 8 to 10 questions in the NEET will be new questions. These questions become the game changer for those, as these can't be solved by mere mugging up of facts. Though they are from NCERT book, to get them right, you need to apply the knowledge that you have about the subject. So this website, we have made an earnest attempt to help you prepare adequately for your NEET. I hope now you have got the framework. And today's chapter, morphology, only one question will be featuring for your NEET exams, not more. It's only one. only one question, that is, he says 2%, but it is very, very less. So it is only one question. I know many books will be giving you so many details and what do you say? It is confusion. It will be very confusing. You can avoid all those things. Please have your textbook with you also, textbook or a notebook. And textbook would also be better so that as and when I tell you how the questions are going to come and feature, you will be able to do it better. Now, this is morphology of the flowering plants. Now, root. So, you know what is morphology? Morphology is the study of various external features of an organism. Now, if I look at it, then immediately you will ask, then about the plant, what is so difficult? But it is an ocean. If you look at it, the details and the what do you say, the concepts running would be running for pages. But we have put everything very concisely so that you don't have to really get perturbed for one mark question. You don't have to study a bulky thing. So I have prepared a slide also, and I would like to tell you how things go. Now, if you look at these parts of a plant, this is your diagram from the text. They might not ask you fruit, but definitely they will ask you a flower. But definitely they will ask you to identify a fruit because it does look a very little odd and it does not confine to the fruits what you have seen. Node and internodes are very important. There's minute thing, bud. So this is very, very important. So please make a note. And primary root. This is the main root that comes is the primary root. And the roots that are coming out from this primary root are the secondary roots. And if you see another branchlet coming, branches coming out from the secondary root, they form the tertiary roots. So this is very important as far as this diagram goes. Now let us get into the roots. Now, whatever I'm going to tell you, all the details you will find in this table. So, what is a tap? What are the different kinds of roots? Where is it seen? And what are the examples? Now, let me begin with root. You know, the underground part of the plant is a root and it develops from the radical of the embryo. And since the taproot is direct elongation of the radical, will give rise to the taproot and hence it goes deeper into the soil. So taproots are also called deep feeders. It bears lateral roots of several order called secondary roots and tertiary roots. The primary roots with its branches form the taproot system and this is seen in dicots. In monocots, you see fibrous root system and these roots originate from the base of the stem and these are called as the surface feeders. Now, adventitious roots originates from the parts of the plant other than the radical. They are seen both in dicots and in monocots. Now, what are the functions of the root? Now, if you ask me, it is very easy. It looks very, what do you say, very simple. Absorption of water and minerals from the soil helps in anchoring the plants in the soil, stores reserve food materials, helps in synthesis of plant growth regulators. Now, let us look at the regions of the root. See, here we have brought in precisely what are the functions and what are the what is the function, what is the type and the example here. Now for the structure of the root, let me explain to you with the help of a diagram. So this is the regions of the root. So this is a root cap. What you see, the structure is a thimble-like structure. It is called as a root cap and it protects the tender root apex as it penetrates deep into the soil. A few full millimeters above this root cap, you find the region of meristematic activity. Here, the cells keep dividing rapidly, and this region has got meristematic activity. That means to say, the cells keep on dividing indeterminately. And the region above this region of meristematic activity is the region of elongation. The cells are responsible for the growth of the root's length. So, how does the root grow in its length? It is due to this region of elongation where the cells elongate the structure. And these cells start gradually differentiating and then they become mature and forming the region of maturation. In the region of maturation, you find root hairs arising that absorb water and mineral salts from the soil. Now, if you look at it, these areas are very important. They might give you in this figure to identify the region of maturation, region of elongation, or region of meristematic activity, or the root cap and root hair. Or they might ask you root hair arises from. region of maturation, region of elongation, or region of meristematic activity. Please remember, root hair arises from region of maturation. Now let us look into we know that the normal functions we have already seen. Now what are some of the functions that are away, that is not normal, but they have been taken up by the root? And such functions, we call it as the modifications. Modifications are seen in root, stem and leaves. Now let us look into the root modifications. Root modifications, you can read pages to pages, but let us stick on to NCERT and see. So the main function here is the support. So you will find two kinds of support roots. One is the prop root and another is the stilt root. Prop roots are found in banyan. You might have seen in banyan, tall pillar-like structures are raising from the branches and entering the ground if the banyan tree is quite old. And these roots are called as the prop roots. Stilt roots are found in maize and sugarcane, and they also help in support. Now there are certain roots that are called as respiratory roots, or which help in respiration. If you look at Rhizophora mangle, it is living in a marshy area, and as a result of which it is soil, it's not able to get oxygen. So what it does is it starts growing out roots that are facing the atmosphere. Please understand this. Roots are positively geotrophic and negatively phototrophic. Here the respiratory roots are positively phototrophic and negatively geotrophic. So here what happens, they come up above, and then they are able to take the oxygen from the atmosphere through pneumatophores. Now storage. So there are certain roots wherein food is stored to overcome unfavorable conditions, or also those stored roots are taken as food by human beings. Now for example, radish, turnip and carrot. Now the common, what are the kind of modification? What is the name for modification? For radish, it is fusiform. For turnip, it is napiform. And carrot, it is conical. Now let us look into the diagram and see how these will be asked. Now this is a turnip. This is a napiform root. Since it is conical in shape, it is a carrot. It is called as conical. Now in sweet potato, it is known as the tuberous root. In sweet potato, it is called as tuberous root. And pneumatophore, if you look at the pneumatophore here, these are the pneumatophores. So this is what helps in absorption of oxygen. Now prop roots, you find them in the banyan trees. So this is an example. One thing they can ask you is napiform, conical, tuberous roots or fusiform. They can ask you with the diagram and ask you to identify with the names. That is what they're going to ask. They will not ask you to identify turnip, carrot, sweet potato or radish. But definitely they will ask you to identify the modifications in what is the name of the modification. So make a note of it. So fusiform, it is in radish. Napiform, it is in turnip. Conical, it is in carrot. Tuberous roots in sweet potato. Now let us get back to the next part, that is the stem. Now stem is the aerial part of the plant. It arises from the plumule. It is positively phototrophic and negatively geotrophic. Now stem has got nodes and internodes. Node is a point on the stem from which leaves are raised, and region between two nodes is an internode. Stem also bears buds that might be terminal or axillary. The main functions of the stem are to spread out branches bearing leaves, flowers and fruits. It contains water, minerals and photosynthetates, but they also get modified to perform the function of storage of food, support, protection and in vegetative propagation. Now let us look into this. So here this gives you very precisely what are the different kinds of modification. See, one thing, you don't have to get into the details to understand what is each type. You just make a note of this. This is important, and that is more than sufficient. For storage, it is a ginger, it is a rhizome. Even turmeric, it is a rhizome. Potato, it is a tuber. Onion, it is a bulb. And colocasia, it is a corm. Now support stem tendrils, you find them in watermelon, grapevine and cucumber. For protection, you might have seen the axillary buds of the stem will get modified into thorns, as in citrus. If you have seen a lemon tree, then you would find the leaves have got small thorn-like structures. That is the modification of the stem. And in bougainvillea also you will find it. So it is a modification of the stem. Now vegetative. So if you look at the underground stem, vegetative means vegetative propagation. So in grass and strawberry, seeds are not formed. So these plants itself will act as perinating organs and they help in vegetative propagation, like in grass, strawberry, mint and jasmine. Now food assimilation. So if you look at xerophytic plants all, the opuntia, the food is getting assimilated, as a result of which the stem becomes very thick. And it even takes up the function of photosynthesis. So this is about the flattened stem of opuntia. Now let us look into stem modifications. So ginger. So in ginger, zameen kand is nothing but elephant yam, and this is the potato. So you should understand what is what. Here they might show you the diagram and ask you to identify, or by giving its botanical names. Now stem modification, here you see they might ask you it's axillary bud modified into a tendril. So here it is a tendril modification, axillary bud, but it is from the stem modification. This diagram they might ask you, and I ask you to identify whether it is a leaf modification or a stem modification. Here stem is modified into a spine. It is in bougainvillea. So they can ask you this diagram and ask you which part is modified into the spine. So, or what is the modification called? So this is called as the spine. So there is a difference between thorn, there is a difference between spine. So here it is a spine. Now let us get back to leaf. Now leaf develops from the shoot apical meristems. It is a flattened green structure, and it is the chief organ for photosynthesis. Now you all know, you're all very familiar with the diagram and all those plants. Now a typical leaf, if you look at it, it consists of three parts. One is the simple leaf. This is a simple leaf. So the three parts are the leaf base. So this is a leaf base. This is the stalk of the leaf called as the petiole. And this is the leaf blade, and this is called as the lamina. Now leaf gets attached to the stem by a leaf base and can bear two lateral structures, and this is called as a stipule. So when there is a presence of stipule in the plant, it is called as a leaf. It is called as stipulate. Or if there is no leaf stipule present, it is called as extipulate. So all these terms I know that you will be utilizing when you are describing a plant technically. Now in monocots, the leaf base expands into a sheath covering stem partially or wholly, forming sheathing leaf base. The lamina or the leaf base, if you look at it, it's a green expanded part of the leaf with veins and veinlets. Now if you look at this leaf, it has got a prominent vein, and it is called as the midrib. Veins provide rigidity to the leaf blade and acts as channels of transport for water, minerals and food materials. Now let us look into venation. So the two types of venation is reticulate venation and parallel venation. In reticulate venation, you will find a midrib, and from the midrib you find veins coming out, and this is known as reticulate venation. If you look at a dicot plant, you will be able to identify very easily, because most of the dicot plants will have reticulate venation. Parallel venation, here the diagram will not have veins like this, but all the lines will be running parallel to the middle one. That means to say you can't identify the mid one or the side lines. All will be having parallel venation. So you imagine they all have parallel lines, and this is known as parallel venation. And most of the monocots have parallel venation. Now this is very important, because the distinguishing features they might ask. So is leaf a distinguishing feature between a dicot and a monocot? Then you should be able to answer yes, because you are able to distinguish based on the venation, whether it is reticulately veined or parallelly veined. Now let us look at types of the leaves. Now here you have a simple leaf, I already showed you here and I already described. Now it is the compound leaf. Simple means one leaf coming out from one node. Now, compound leaf means you might have seen a neem. Each branch has got many leaflets coming. So when the incisions of the lamina reach up to the midrib, baking into number of leaflets, the leaf is called as a compound leaf. And compound leaves can be pinnately compound or palmately compound. So in pinnately compound, it has got number of leaflets present on a common axis, the rachis, which represents the midrib. Example, neem. So this is how you find it in pinnately compound. So there is one rachis, and on this you will find leaves. And at the terminal point, if it ends with only one leaf, then it is called as imparipinnate pinnately compound leaf. If there are two leaves, you call it as paripinnately pinnately compound leaf. Now let us look at palmately compound leaf. So if you look at this leaf, it appears like your fingers in a palm. That's why it's called as palmately compound. The leaflets are attached to a common point, as you see in silk cotton. Now let us look at the next thing is phyllotaxy. So pattern of arrangement of the leaves on the stem or a branch is known as phyllotaxy. See, these definitions are very important. So what is this pattern of arrangement of leaves on the stem or a branch is known as phyllotaxy. There can be many arrangements, but please remember only these. One is alternate phyllotaxy, opposite phyllotaxy, and whorled phyllotaxy. So if it is an alternate thing, there is one leaf coming from one node on alternate side of the stem, and this is known as alternate phyllotaxy. So if you look at this, you will understand. See, at one node, one leaf. The next, it will be on the opposite, on the next node. That is why it is called as alternate. In opposite phyllotaxy, each two leaves are raised from each node. And this is known as opposite phyllotaxy. In old phyllotaxy, just like a whorl, all the leaves will be arranged from a common point, giving a whorled appearance. That's why it's called as whorled phyllotaxy. Now let us look at the leaf modifications. There are many modifications, but these are very, very important. One is the leaf tendril. Stem tendril is also there. Leaf tendril is also there. It is for the purpose of climbing sweet wild pea. So this is a leaf tendril. Now it is a spine. Spines are there. Leaves get modified into spines for the purpose of protection. You find that in Aloe, Opuntia, and an Argemone. If you look in Argemone, you will find the spines coming out right in the leaves, all over the leaf, from the center of the leaves. It will be very difficult. And this is one of an adaptation for the plant to keep away from the predators. Now, picture plant. Now, you might be wondering, in what way in picture plant is it taking up the function of nutrition? So, you know that picture plant grows in a soil which is deficient in nitrogen. So, nitrogen is a very important element for all the plants because of the physiological role this element plays in the life of a plant. So, if you look at a picture plant, its leaf blade will get modified into a picture so that when an insect sits on it, it gets trapped and the insect will be totally digested and the nitrogen from the insect's body will be absorbed. So, this is known as the this is how it helps in the nutrition to get its nitrogen content. Now, this is seen in Nepenthes. That is the botanical name for picture plant. The other modification is it could get modified into a hook. So, what do hooks do? Hooks always help you in supporting. And similarly, in cat's tail, it gets modified it for support. So, if you remember this, that is more than sufficient. Now let us look into leaf modifications here. See here, they might ask you this diagram and they can show you in the stem modification this. This is for support and this is also for support. This is a leaf tendril and there it is a stem tendril. There, these two diagrams can be asked, A is what, B is what. So they might ask you to do it. Now here leaves are getting modified into spines, cactus, it is for protection. For storage, if you see, it is the onions, the fleshy leaves that are getting modified. If you look at it, in onion there are two modifications. The leaf is getting modified into fleshy leaves. Stem is also getting modified, that is a bulb. The entire structure is called as the bulb and it is a stem modification. Fleshy leaves are the modification for storage purpose. Now, I hope you are clear with root, stem and leaf. Now let us look into inflorescence. So this is the inflorescence, is the branch in which the flowers are borne. So it is said to be as an inflorescence, that is arrangement of flowers on the floral axis is known as the inflorescence. There are two types of inflorescence. One is racemose inflorescence, the other is cymose inflorescence. So if you look at racemose inflorescence, it is also an indeterminate inflorescence. That is, the main axis will continue to grow and grow, and flowers are seen in acropetal succession. Acropetal means, since it is continuously growing, the older flowers will be at the bottom, newer flowers will be at the top. So it is growing acropetally, and example are radish, mustard and amaranthus. In cymose inflorescence, the main axis will terminate into flowers, and flowers are seen in basipetal. Basipetal means, since it is a determinate type of inflorescence, older flowers will be at the top and new flowers will be found at the bottom. This is seen in cotton, calotropis and in jasmine. Now, this inflorescence, what we have looked is, they have given only these two. But since we have looked into the question papers and what kind of questions have been asked, I have put some slides. I will give you time. You don't have to get into the details about this, but please make a note of the type of inflorescence with examples. Examples: simple raceme, mustard, panicle, goldmohur, corymb, candytuft, spike, bottle brush, spikelet, wheat, catkin, mulberry, spadix, palm, umbel, coriander, capitulum, sunflower. So I give you 2 minutes time for you to copy this, because this is very, very important. They don't ask you the details, but they will ask you the kind of inflorescence, though it is not there in NCERT text. As I said, there are some game changers. Some questions may come straight from the past year's papers. So if you look at the old papers, 98, 99, all these were included in biology. So if the examiner just sets as a game changer question, you people should take the benefit of it and should be able to hit the answer. That is the reason why I am giving you this. So I move on to the next slide. Inflorescence and cymose, uniparous or monocacial sign, it's seen in potato. Biparous or dicacial sign, seen in night jasmine. Multiparous or monocacial sign, seen in dianthus. Now, let me get back to the flower. So, flower is a modified shoot for reproduction. Now, how are flowers classified? There can be many criteria for classifying the flower, but I'm only going to give you what is mentioned in your NCERT point of view and from your NEET point of view. It is based on the symmetry. So, based on the symmetry, if a flower can be divided into two halves by a plane through passing through its center, then it is known as an actinomorphic flower. It's also similar to radial symmetry of animal kingdom. Example, mustard, datura and chili. Zygomorphic, if the flower is divisible into two halves, then it is known as zygomorphic. It is analogous to bilateral symmetry of the animal kingdom. Example, pea, pear, goldmohur and cassia. Asymmetric, irregular, it cannot be divided into any two halves, like asymmetric, as in it's an irregular flower, as in canna. Now, based on floral appendages. Now, if you look at the appendages, if all the calyx, corolla, andricium, and gynecium, they are called as the appendages. If the calyx and corolla and carpels and stamens all occur in three and multiples of three, then it is called trimerous. Example, lily and onion. Tetramerous, if they all occur in four and multiples of four, as in mustard. and pentameters if they are in 5 and multiples of 5, as in hibiscus. Again, the floral appendages can also help you in identifying whether the plant is a dicot or a monocot. If it is a trimerous, it is a monocot. If it is pentamerous or tetramerous, it is a dicot. Now, on the basis of the arrangement of floral whorls with respect to ovary. So, now let me explain to you using the position of the floral parts on the thalamus. Now, if you look at this, this structure is the ovary. Hypogynous means below. Hypo is below. Gynous is gynecium. So, if the floral other appendages are arising, calyx, corolla and andrecium are arising below the ovary, then you call it as hypogynous and the position of the ovary is said to be superior. Perigynous means at the rim. As a result of which, some parts may arise above, some parts may arise below, and it is half inferior and half superior. That is why this condition, these two conditions are perigynous conditions, and this is epigynous. Epi is above. So, above the gynecium. So, the ovary comes down, and above it, all the other appendages will arise or other whorls will arise, and this is what is known as the epigynous condition. And now the ovary is said to be inferior. See, this diagram is very important. They might give you these and ask you to identify the conditions which is hypo, which is peri, and which is epi. You can't memorize. See, this is very easy for you to analyze. You just see the position of the ovary. If the ovary is above, then it is hypogynous. Then if it is halfway like this, some coming that way, some coming this way, then it is peri. Epi means above the ovary, other whorls will arise, and this is known as epigynous condition. Now let us get into parts of the flower. Now parts of a flower, if you look at it, you have got four whorls. They are calyx, corolla, andrecium and gynecium. Now if it is a complete flower, it will have both calyx and andrecium and gynecium, and all the four whorls will be present. Then why? That's why it's called as a complete flower or a bisexual flower. If any one whorl is present, then it is called a unisexual flower. If only stamen is present, it is called as staminate flower, or pistil is present, it is called as a pistillate flower. Now this is about the flowers. Now let me get into the details of andrecium. This is very important. So, andrecium, you know that it is made up of a stamen, and this stamen has got a filament here, and this has got the anther. Within the anther, you will find the anther lobes, and within the anther lobes, pollens are produced. This you will learn it in the next, grade 12 first lesson, second lesson, then I'll be explaining it to you in detail. Now, these are certain things which you have to understand. One is staminode. Staminode is a sterile stamen. So these terms, you please make a note of it. Epipetalous, stamens are attached to petals. Example, brinjal. Epiphyllous, so stamens are attached to perianth. Perianth means calyx and corolla, they can't be differentiated in monocots. So these are called as the perianth, and the individual units are called the tepals. Now polyandrous, free stamens, example lotus and rose. Monodelphous, example is China rose. Diadelphous, that is the stamens are all found in one single bundle, then it is known as monoadelphous condition. When they are found in two bundles as in P, it is called as diadelphous. If they are occurring in multiple bundles, then you call it as polydelphous as in citrus. Now let me get into gynecium. You know, this is a ovary. Above the ovary, there is a long tube-like structure, and this is called as the style. On top of the style is the stigma. Now, stigma has got the structures that are receptive to the pollen grain. So, you know that when a pollen grain falls on the stigma, it gets activated, and then it starts germinating the pollen tube through the style. Actually, the stigma has got the bears the surface receptors to identify the same species. Suppose if the pollen of unrelated plant comes and falls, it does not germinate, because the stigma has got the chemical properties there to show to identify whether it belongs to the same species or to a different species. Now, what are the different terms you use for this entire structure is called as a carpel. Multicarpellary means presence of more than one carpel. Suppose you find like this many things, then it is called as multicarpellary structure. Apocarpus, carpels are free, example, lotus and rose. Syncarpus, carpels are united, example, mustard and tomato. So I hope you have understood about the flower and the position of the flower. Now let us get to know the types of aestivation. So this aestivation, you might have seen a calyx, you might have seen a corolla. Now what are the different types of aestivation? Valvate, twisted, imbricate and vexillary. Now if you look at valvate aestivation, now all these things will be in the form of a whorl. So all will be touching at the edges only, and this is known as the valvate aestivation. See, these diagrams are very important because they might give the aestivation structure, and then they might ask you to identify the kind of aestivation, or they can give you the example and then ask you to identify the aestivation. Suppose they might ask the kind of aestivation seen in Calotropis. They will give you the pictures. Then you have to identify it as a valvate. It is very simple. In valvate aestivation, the margins will not overlap with each other. They will just touch the margins. In twisted aestivation, if you look at it, out of the five, you will have one in and out. That is, one will go outside the other and one will be inside. Like this, you will find three. And two will be completely in. And sorry, one will be completely in and one will be... In twisted, it is in and out. All the five will be in and out. Example, China rose and cotton. In imbricate, if you look at it, out of the three, one will be totally inside, one will be totally outside, and three will alternate with one in and one out. So this is what we call it as imbricate aestivation. This is seen in Cassia and Gulmaha. In vexillary, you have a standard petal, and these are the keel petals, and this is typical of papilionaceous family and leguminosae. You please remember, in bean and pea, this is the kind of aestivation, and it is known as the vexillary aestivation. So the types of aestivation are valvate, twisted, imbricate and vexillary. This is also important because for your theory, you might have practiced drawing for calyx and corolla, the different kinds of aestivation. Now, let us get into placentation. So, the last part, what we are going to, now, before we complete this, we will see what are the things that are left out, placentation. So, marginal placentation, axi, parietal and free central. Again, I'm telling you, they can ask you the kind of placentation found in pea plant, kind of placentation found in mustard, like this, or they can give you, identify the placentation in China rose. Then these diagrams will be given. You have to identify which suits it. Now, what is marginal placentation? The placentation forms a ridge along the ventral suture of the ovary, and ovules are born on this ridge forming two rows. Example is pea. Placenta is in axile position and ovules are arranged as in multilocular ovary condition, and this is known as axile placentation seen in China rose and tomato. In parietal placentation, ovules develop on the inner wall of the ovary or on the peripheral part. Ovary is one chamber, but here you will see two chambers here. There is a formation of a false septa. Example, mustard and argemon, and free central or basal, these are the two things. In free central, ovules are born on the central axis and the septa is absent. So that is why it is called as free central. Example, dianthus and primrose. In basal placentation, it develops at the base of the ovary and a single ovule is attached as in marigold. So this is very, very important. Again, the examples. See, that's why I suggest you go for the PDF so that it becomes very easy for you to understand certain concepts very easily, and it is striking your eye. So the visual presentations will help you to remember things better. Now, fruit. After fertilization, the mature ovary develops into fruit. The parthenocarpic fruits are formed from ovary without fertilization. Now, the fruit is broadly divided into pericarp and the seed. Now, pericarp is divided into epicarp, that is the outermost layer. Mesocarp is the middle layer and endocarp is the innermost layer. Now, if you look at the seed, seed is divided into seed coat and embryo. Now, embryo is divided into embryonal axis and cotyledons. Now, if you look at the embryonal axis, this axis will have a plumule and a radicle and cotyledons, and it will store the food. Now, this is what has been concisely put and comprehensively put in the PDF. Now, let us look in for some more details, because they become the game changers. Now let us look at the classification of fruits. This is very important, children. Please make a note of it. They have asked in previous years. Now the technical name of mango is drupe, tomato berry, pear pumpkin, pome apple, hesperidium orange or citrus fruit. So make a note of this slide. I give you 2 minutes. Sorry. Now let us look into classification of fruits. So dry fruits are divided into dehiscent and indehiscent fruits. Dry fruits are follicle calotropis, legume interspis. I'm sorry, there is a spelling mistake. It is siliqua. S-I-L-I-Q-U-A, siliqua. It is radish. Capsule, it is datura. D-A-T-U-R-A. So make a note of these things, children. Now indehiscent fruits, that which can't be divided. Akin, narvelia. Caryopsis maize, nut chestnut, Samara hiptage, Schizocar coriander. So please make a note of this. I give you 2 minutes time because this is very important and they have repeatedly asked in old papers and these can become the game changers for you. Okay, now shall I get into the next thing? This is a dicot seed. This is very, very important. They will ask you to identify the parts. So here the important is seed coat. This is the hilum. This is the micropyle. Micropyle is a pore-like structure. This is a cotyledon plumule radicle. So very easy for a dicot seed. So the outer layer is called as the testa and inner is called as the tegmen. Now you find this hilum. Hilum is a scar on the seed coat through which developing seeds were attached to the fruit. Micropyle is a small pore above the hilum. Now if you look at the within the seed coat is the embryo, and this embryo has got an embryonal axis and a cotyledons. If 2 cotyledons are found, it is called as a dicot. If only 1 cotyledon is there, it is a monocot. Here you are finding a dicot seed, and then the embryonal axis, the lower part has got the radicle. This will develop into the root system, and plumule is the shoot which will develop into, plumule develops into the shoot system. Now monocot seed. Now if you look at this, seed coat is membranous and it is fused with the fruit wall. Endosperm, this is the endosperm, and this is bulky and it stores the food. The outer covering of the endosperm, this is called as the aluron layer, separates the embryo from the endosperm, and this structure is now called as the embryo. It is covered by a sheathing structure called as scutellum. Then it has got 2 parts. One is the plumule. Plumule is surrounded by sheaths called coleoptile, which will protect the plumule, and this develops into the shoot system. This is the radicle, which will develop into the root system, and this is covered by the coleorrhiza. So coleoptile covers the plumule, coleorrhiza covers the radicle. So remember, rhiza means radicle, that is the root, RRR. Now coleoptile is the plumule. Is it clear? Now let us look into economically important plants. Now this floral diagrams and floral formula are very, very important. Only for 3 families you have to learn. Please learn them together properly. This is your Fabaceae. Now the important, economically important plants I have given, please make a note. This they have asked you to identify. They will not ask you the common names, but they will ask you the botanical names. And that is why I have given you here. If you look at gram, it is Sizer arancinum, Arhar Kajanus kajan, Moong Vigna radiata, groundnut Arachis hypogea, indigofera, it is a dye plant from which you are going to get the blue dye, and that is called botanically indigofera tinctoria. Sun hemp is Crotalaria junctia, river hemp is Sesbania trifolium. So please make a note of this. I give you time. See, the questions that can erase from this side are, what are the pulses here? So, sizer arrangement is pulses, kajana is a pulses, vigna is a pulse again, like this. Then oil seed among the following, they will not as moong, arhar or groundnut. Like this, they will not ask. You will be able to identify. They will give you the botanical names and then they will ask you to identify. If you look at the economic importance section in your book, in the end they have given, but the botanical names are missing. So I have supplemented the botanical names for those plants. Now Solanaceae, again this floral formula and floral diagram is very important. You had to learn it, because these floral diagrams, they will not ask for the families directly. They will give you some example. For example, the floral diagram of Brinjalis. They will give you different floral diagrams and ask you to identify. Then you have to look in which suits for Solanaceae, and then you should be able to pick it up and write. Similarly, now let us look at economic importance. Tomato, Lycopersicon, Esculentum, Brinjal, Solanum melongena, Chili, Capsicum annuum, Belladonna, Medicinal, Atropa belladonna, Ashwagandha, it is also medicinal, Vithania somnifera, Tobacco, Nicotiana, Tobacum. Please make a note of this. I give you 2 minutes. Okay, now let me go to the Liliaceae. This is the last family. So this is the floral diagram of the Liliaceae family. And now the economic importance, tulip, tulipa species, onion, Allium sepa, garlic, Allium sativum. These two you have to learn the botanical names, children. Lily, Lilium species, aloe, aloe barbadens. Now I'm also giving you miscellaneous names. Please have a look at it and make a note. Rice, the Oryza sativum is the botanical name. Wheat, it is Triticum maestivum. Cabbage, Brassica oleracea, variety capitata. Again, this is Brassica oleracea, variety botrytis. So these are the things which you have to know. Cabbage and cauliflower, it is very important. They might ask you the botanical names of cabbage and cauliflower respectively are. And this children will get confused. They will get Brassica oleracea correctly, whether it is variety capitata or whether it is botrytis. Capitata means head. So in the cabbage, if you see, you just look at the grooves of your brain, like you imagine like that, then you can identify it as capitata. So with this, this completes your revision of the lesson, Morphology of Flowering Plants. Now let us get back to the test. So I said morphology, let us look into test 3 today. What's happened? Okay. From the region of maturation, some epidermal cells that are thin, very delicate, thread-like structures that absorb water and minerals are called root hairs. The arrangement of flowers on the floral axis is termed as inflorescence. Racemos and cymos are the types of inflorescence. The 4 different kinds of whorls arranged successively on the stalk are calyx, corolla, andricium, and gynecium. A flower may be tetramerous when the floral appendages are in multiples of 4. The 3 parts of the leaf are leaf base, petiole, and lamina. A leaf is said to be compound when the incisions of the lamina reach up to the midrib, breaking into number of leaflets. The pattern of arrangement of leaves on the stem is called phyllotaxy. The difference between pinnately compound leaf and the palmately compound leaf is leaflets are present in a common axis in the former and at a common point in the later. Based on the position of calyx, Corolla and andrecium. In respect of the ovary on the flowers, the thalamus, the flowers are described as epigynous, hypogynous, and perigynous. Aestivation is the mode of arrangement of sepals or petals in floral bud with respect to other members of the same whorl. The names valvate, imbricate, and vexillary are papillary. Are clanoflower, that is, it is an aestivation. Andrecium is male reproductive organ and gynecium is the female reproductive organ group of a flower. The type of placentation where the placenta forms a ridge along the ventral suture of the ovary and ovules are borne on this ridge, forming two rows as in P. It is none of the above because it has to be marginal placentation, so it is none of the above. Epicarp, mesocarp, and endocarp are the parts of a pericarp of a fruit. See, you might find them in coconut, you might find them in mango fruit and guava fruit, but these terms are the common terms and they have also given the word pericarp. So even if you take all these things, the choice will be wrong. So the correct answer will be pericarp of the fruit. Epicarp, okay, I am sorry, I didn't save it. Save and next. The modifications of leaves can be to, for protection, climb trees, all of the above, store food. So it is for all of the above. So I'm going to end the test here. So here all the questions are correct. Suppose if I have not attempted this question, question number 4, then I can see an yellow color in the legend. If it is red, I will be seeing it as incorrect. If I click on that answer, then the correct answer will be displayed. Suppose I have got this wrong, you think. Now, a leaf is said to be compound when. So here I have got it right, it says, but suppose if this was wrong, then this will be your answer. And in the red, it will be showing this as your answer. Green one will be highlighting and showing that is the correct answer. Okay. So this completes today's lesson. Now, if you look at this NEET series, as I said, you have got around so many tests, and with this we come to the end of today's class. NEET packages are 38 3-hour full tests. See here, this is what I'm trying to tell you, with 15 original tests. That means these are all being created by the tutors, taking into account the three types of questions, that is NCERT based, your previous past years, and also the game changers, so that it is totally new to which you would not have seen those questions earlier, and 20 plus past NEET papers all solved with solutions. If you want to get any additional chapter by using our Ask Teacher on our site, and we support chat group using Telegram, you can book your slots for one-to-one teaching with the tutors. For any queries, please mail your query to info@clay6.com. This will help you to have a contact, and immediately your queries will be answered. And depending upon what is best, you can decide whether you want to take the package or you want to go with the tutor. But I would personally tell you that you better go in for the packages, because there are umpteen number of questions, especially if you look at it word to word, you will become thorough by the end. Anything, and the students who have taken it have also said within 2.5 hours or 2 hours, 45 minutes, they are able to complete the paper. So that being the case, try to avail the best use of the time. You have enough time now. Avail the time and you can go in for the package, which is quite affordable, not very expensive. So with this, I end today's class. Tomorrow, we meet again, children. Thank you.